Greetings, everyone. Michele Granberg here. Welcome to Positive Energy, where topics open your heart and inspire your soul. Are you ready to improve your relationship with yourself and others? On this show, we have two amazing guests, starting with Stacey Simpson, counselor, coach, and relationship expert. Then we're joined later in the show by Tina C. Hines, life transformation specialist, to share tips about cultivating positive self-esteem for women. So you want to stay with us. The show is sure to inspire, starting with Stacey Simpson. So hey, Stacey Simpson, welcome to Positive Energy.
Thank you very much, Michele.
I'm so glad to have you here. I know that you and I have known each other for a long time, and so it's really interesting to have us sitting here across the table from one another here on my show, and I'm just really happy to have you, and I want to say that I want to acknowledge you for the work that you do in the world, and I appreciate that you're in my life that way.
Thank you. Yes, we've known each other. I won't say how many years, but we've known each other a very long time, since our 20s, and what's been very cool, I mean, this feels full circle to me to like be back here with you, because I remember just back then when we both wanted to be counselors and we both wanted to help. And, you know, we were on the same path like very early when a lot of our friends weren't. So it's just very cool to like still be in touch, teach at your center, and have the chance to come back here and just still be such great friends.
So your path has led you to some really cool work that I wanted you to share with people on the show today. We're going to talk a little bit about dating success and about relationships, which
yes,
are both very sticky areas for people in some ways and very relevant for people as well. But start out by saying just a little bit about yourself as a professional, a little bit about your background, credentials, and your business.
Okay, so I've been a counselor for 25 years, long time. I've had a practice called the Life Connection for 18 years, where I offer coaching, counseling, and classes, all types. I'm a licensed counselor. I'm trained in NLP, which is basically neuro-linguistic programming, how to create your best life, hypnosis. I'm a divorce mediator, a custody evaluator, a co-parent counselor. I'm trained in dating and single parent and relationship coaching, as well as being a college psychology professor. So I teach at Drexel, Princeton University, which is right down the street, I think, right?
Yes.
Princeton's very close, yeah. So, I think I know where I am here. So, yeah, and so I pretty much divide my time between teaching at the college level, as well as teaching in my own center, as well as offering coaching, counseling for people. Primarily at this point, people midlife, 30s, 40s, 50s, and doing a lot of relationship coaching.
Well, let's dive a little bit deeper into all of that. And say a little bit about why you are so passionate about the area of dating and relationships.
I always have been, which is, I think, why I became a counselor. I love talking about love. And at the end of the day, I mean, when you think about it, when you're with your friends, I mean, we saw each other recently, what do you talk about? You talk about your relationships. And, you know, no matter what somebody comes into my office to talk about, and almost no matter what the...
It circles,
it's all about,
it goes back to that, yeah.
Yeah.
Relationships, so, yep.
And when your relationships aren't right, or if one or more relationships isn't right, mm-hmm, you tend not to be happy. And so I love helping people figure out how to be happy in that way. And if for some reason somebody got it right in the romantic department, they met their person in high school or college, they got into the relationship and they're done and it's perfect, cool. But a lot of people, that doesn't happen. The trajectory of their life changes. You know, they meet somebody, maybe it's not right, maybe they get a divorce, and now they're sort of back out there again. And so I love helping people figure out how to date, yeah, who to date, how to let go, how to choose the right person, and how to be happy again.
Very interesting. I just have to repeat what you said, because you said, I love talking about love.
Oh, I do.
I love that. I love, yeah, that you said that. It's all about the love.
I do. This is my favorite topic. Today I was at my college class and I was supposed to be talking about something else, and I started talking about this. I gave my class a survey. I said, this is what I'm going to talk about. What do you guys think about love?
What else is there? It's very rewarding, right? And when you really do help people to find love, that's the ultimate.
Find
and
love,
it's,
and
so
keep,
rewarding.
Keep love too. I mean, make the relationships work. That's also phenomenal.
So let's talk more about that, because what are some of the common mistakes that you hear people making overall in dating or in approaching relationships?
Okay, so in terms of dating, a lot of times people don't know what they want. in the person that they're dating, or they don't know what, they focus on really superficial things. Like they'll say something like, I had a client, and this is, it's amazing who she ended up picking, but she said, I want somebody who's 6'2" who likes country music. And that was her criteria for her dating. Meanwhile, the person, meanwhile, the person she was with was like abusive and lied and cheated and all of these different things. He wasn't 6'2". He was, I think it was like 5'2". But she had this idea about common interests and things like that, but she wasn't really focused on the characteristics and qualities of the person.
I say, I call it the essence of someone.
Right. So,
which people, is really where compatibility comes from.
Absolutely.
Right? Having matching essence or chemistry in that way.
Right. Yeah. So, I mean, interests are important. For instance, if your person likes football, it doesn't mean that you have to like football. It just means you have to understand that they like football and they're going to go watch it, but you don't have to go with them. You don't even have to sit there with them, but give them the space to go do that. But, you know, so that's one of the things that happens. I think people are very focused on that. You also brought up chemistry. I think that people are very laser focused on the spark, chemistry. Do we have it? Don't we have it? They sometimes make very quick decisions about that. Sometimes within seconds of sitting across from somebody, they make like really quick judgments. And I think that's something that you need to have. It's essential, but it's something that can grow over time as
well. That's good to hear. That's good news for people as well. And gives them a different perspective.
Right.
Definitely more realistic kind of perspective on that. So you and I are in our divine midlife.
Yeah.
And so we can relate to other divine midlifers.
I haven't heard it said that way. But my midlife.
I just coined that. So talk a little bit about what the particular challenges are when it comes to dating in midlife.
Okay. So I think one of the things is my sister and I call it the land of misfit toys. I mean, it's Christmas time and Rudolph is on. Do you remember that from Rudolph?
Yes.
And, you know, Hermie the dentist goes to the land of like, and I think Rudolph ends up there too. But the point is, a lot of broken toys there.
Are we the broken toys this metaphor?
No, we're not the broken toys, but there's a lot of broken toys out there. I mean, when you're in your teens, 20s, early 30s, it's a lot of healthy people sort of getting ready to start a relationship. Mm. When you get out to midlife, oftentimes there's a couple reasons why you're single again. One is that maybe you focused too much on your career or an area of your life and you didn't put the energy in. You sort of looked up and you're like, okay, I guess I need to find somebody. So that's one reason. Mm-hmm. One of the most common reasons is people get a divorce or they end a long-term relationship and so suddenly they're available again. But sometimes it's because there's a group of people out there that are sort of unhealthy, whether it be addiction or mental health issues or something like that. People are unhealthy, and so you sort of have to avoid those misfit toys, not us misfit toys, but those misfit toys. Right. You have to like really just sort of get clear. So in midlife, there's not as many options, but you only need one person.
Yeah.
So I think it's putting yourself out there. I think a lot of midlifers get really caught up in, I have my friends, I have my work,
they
I have my kids.
They get a little stuck in a rut a little bit, in a routine, a comfort zone.
They don't date. That's another thing. They just take big periods of time where they don't date.
Right, right.
And they're very set in their ways sometimes. It's like, I need somebody that's 15 miles from me and they need to be this age and they have to go to bed at this time and they have to like these things and like a real lack of, like not flexible,
right.
You know? So those are some of the challenges, I think.
Well, I think there's some good tips in there, right? Approach it with some flexibility.
Definitely.
And approach it with consciousness or deliberate intent in terms of making it a part of your life. Like
A goal and a priority. I mean, the whole thing where people say, well, when I'm least expecting it and I'm not looking, I'll find it. And
not
I'm like,
necessarily. Or it will take a really long time.
Yeah, like put yourself out there. I mean, when you get to midlife, most of the people are married or they're in relationships. You've met your friends. You've done all that. So you have to like put an extra effort out there to meet new people.
Well, I have to say that's how I met my husband. I made it a goal. I made it a point of this is going to happen. And I moved and took actions towards that.
Yeah.
So let's talk another area for us divine midlifers is single parenting. There's lots of single parents out there for various reasons, and they want to date. So what do you tell people and what do you hear are the special concerns for single parents who are dating?
Okay, so I'm a single parent, and I've been dating as a single parent.
Hello.
Divine
coming
midlifer.
Coming out of the closet, I'm a single parent.
I'm a single parent, which I love. I mean, she's the best decision I've ever made. So. You know, sometimes you marry the wrong person and, you know, you become a single parent. And so I think there's a lot of special things, you know, special issues that go on with single parents. One is figuring out how to prioritize your work, your children. Like, there tends to be a lack of balance for single parents sometimes, because you have less money, less time, and your energy is all over the place. So I think it's, like you said earlier, it's making dating a priority. When your children are young, sometimes you take breaks, you know, in dating. You say, well, my children need me, they're young, or, you know, they become teenagers, they're not around much, they're with you, you're like, I'll take it, like whatever energy they have to give you. But I think that it's, there's making dating a priority, and sometimes there's, I can't tell you how often I hear, we don't have the same weekends. It's like the luck of the draw. Either you're on the same weekends, because most single parents have some type of shared or primary custody schedule where they alternate weekends. Mm-hmm. And you meet somebody who's also probably a single parent, and you're like, uh-oh, we don't have the same weekends. And then things get off, but who cares? Like, you can work that stuff out, like no big deal. Like, values and compatibility are a little more
important.
Those are
the details, right?
Than those things. So I think it's, your children are extremely important, they're everything, but I think that you need to create space and time to date when you're a single parent.
So there's lots of challenges, but there's lots of ways around that if you're willing to maybe listen and learn too, and maybe talk to an expert or read a good book around that.
Yes.
Let's jump to relationships, because that's the point, right?
Yeah.
We're dating, now let's say we're getting into a relationship. So what you found some of the biggest challenges within relationships, why they struggle or why they fail, or, you know, what becomes that block for people?
Okay, so sort of like what will make a relationship work or not work sort of thing? Is that what you're asking?
Yeah, I guess, yeah, what are the problems, and then what are some of the great tools for that?
Okay, cool. So some of the challenges are people choose the wrong person. you're not a good fit. So that's one thing. I mean, people try to like a square peg, round hole. Like, people try to make a relationship work sometimes. And so that's one thing.
So how do they know? Because it's just not working in general.
And when something's not working, it's sort of like becoming a detective. Why isn't this working? What are the problems? Mm-hmm. What's preventing the change, and what do you have to do to change it? Hmm. Some problems are fixable and some problems aren't fixable. So for instance, you know, I have a couple in my office now. She has mental health issues, and the mental health issues, she has some personality disorders, are not easily fixable. They're pretty resistant to change. Some mental health issues are super fixable. Hmm. Let's say somebody has an addiction. That's fixable if the person's working on it and they're willing to change. There's trust, honesty, there's like all types of reasons why relationships aren't working. Sometimes underneath all that, people are very dissimilar as people. They're just not a great fit for each other. They don't make each other happy. So sometimes it's like tangible things that people can change, and sometimes like underneath it all, people just are not very similar and they would be much happier with somebody else.
Yeah. So it's being able to know the difference, or engage maybe a professional to have an objective view on that sometimes as well. So what are the things, we want people to remain really hopeful.
Definitely.
I always, in my life, want people to be really hopeful, because I'm a success story.
Yes,
you know,
you
finding
are.
Someone later in life. So what do you say to people to keep them inspired and hopeful and encourage them?
Okay, so it only takes one person. And you just have to put yourself out there. I mean, some of the things that are sort of successful tips in dating, it's being aware of like the three C's. So chemistry, you have to have some type of like physical, sexual connection, attraction. There's compatibility, that's extremely important. You know, and then there's great communication. So
Three C's.
I will say them again.
Communication.
Compatibility. And chemistry.
Beautiful.
Thank you.
I love when you boil it down to that. So you do lots of great work in the world here locally.
Thank you.
Tell people where your office is and then your website, how they can reach you.
Sure. Okay, so my office is in Lower Gwinnett, Pennsylvania, but I know I'm in New Jersey, so don't let that deter anybody here, because I do Skype, phone, and in-person coaching counseling. So I'm a traditional counselor, but I also have the holistic background. I have both. And so sometimes insurances will cover it, sometimes they won't. So I'm in Lower Gwinnett. However, I travel around. I'm at your center sometimes, teaching dating classes and other things. And so I'm offering a lot of online classes for 2016 especially, on dating and coaching people to create great relationships, single parent stuff, create your best life, NLP, hypnosis, all of that. My website is Stacey, S-T-A-C-E-Y, Simpson.com. On my website there, if somebody wants to sort of stay in touch, I have a free ebook called 5 Minutes to Create Your Best Life. And if they put their name and they put their email address, they'll get the free ebook, but then they'll also stay on my list, and there's a lot of like free classes and permissions and all of that.
Okay, great. Well, Stacey, thank you very much for being here. It was really a pleasure.
It was a pleasure. No, I loved being here with you, Michele. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. So I'm here with Tina C. Hines, Life Transformation Specialist, and we're going to continue our conversation about relationships and sort of segue into our relationship with ourselves, especially as women, which is very important because really all other relationships sort of follow that.
Yes.
So this is the most important relationship we're going to talk about. So Tina, tell us a little bit about yourself and why you're so passionate about working with women.
I started helping women about 4 years ago out of my love for seeing women live healthier and happier. I've been working in corporate America for over 30 years, and one of the things I observed was women were existing, but they weren't truly living.
Right.
They're going through their daily activities, they're taking care of the family, they're taking care of their bosses, and they're forgetting to practice self-care. And after observing that, I recognized that there needed to be something for them to do in order to transform those behaviors. And it just came out of a love for seeing what I call my sisters, because I'm an only child, so I call all women my sisters, seeing them live healthier and happier, because life is too short to just be existing.
Well, your passion for it really shows. Yeah. It really exudes. And I've been following your work, and I just want to say I really appreciate and acknowledge the work that you're doing in the world with women.
Thank you so much.
That we have folks like you out there. So talk a little bit more. I think everybody knows what self-love is and self-care and self-esteem, but say a little bit more about that and why it's so vital to who we are as healthy, mature, functioning, happy beings. Yeah.
You know, self-love and self-care, how they go together. Often we are looking for love from other people, and it's hard to get or know exactly what it is that we would like because we don't give it to ourselves. I like to encourage the ladies to always do something like a self-love bath. And they ask, what is a self-love bath? What exactly does that mean, Tina? And that means taking time to be with yourself and having a bath with your favorite soap or bubbles or whatever you like, and quiet music, music with no words, so you can really hear yourself think. And then also have your journal ready, so whatever emotion that comes up while you're focusing on yourself and your needs, you're able to write it in your journal, and that's a self-love bath.
And how do people respond when you suggest that? Do you get any resistance, or do people go, really? Or do they say, I can give myself permission to do that, to just take a love bath?
Well, what's interesting.
And am I going to do this alone, or is someone going to be with me?
All depends on what area of the country they're in, because most Caribbean places, they don't have bathtubs.
Oh.
They have a shower, so I have to tell them how to do it with a shower.
Same difference.
Yes.
Yeah.
But it's interesting because the emotions are unique to each person's challenges that they're facing.
Right.
It can be something where they're laughing hysterically because they're remembering something from their childhood. Or it can be very, you know, they're sad because they're remembering that they're not taking care of themselves. And how to take that time just for like 25 minutes or a half an hour, it's like, I've been forgetting to do this for myself. Right. And the response of what they've written in their journals of their past has always been very interesting for the ladies to share and discovery.
I think a lot of people can really relate to that, and it's important to say this as a priority, you know, in women's lives. So what's sort of the reason or the challenge or the block that women lose their sense of self or forget themselves in that way? I know some of it is stress and just that life is busy and chaotic, but you talk about women having personal storms, that there's always something in a woman's life, very often, those sort of critical moments. So talk a little bit about that.
So when I think about the storms, it's sometimes the challenges that they've faced in their past that they really haven't healed from.
Yeah.
They say they're okay, but they're truly not okay because they have not truly worked on it with a coach or with a physician, a psychiatrist, and they haven't worked on transforming that behavior. So once they go on in life, they're figuring why they're trying to understand why their relationships aren't going well, why they're having difficulties in their job, and they don't recognize that their past is having effect on their present.
So how do you work with them, either in groups or one-on-one in coaching? How do you sort of gently guide them to heal What are some of the other tools or tips that you use?
Some of the tools, I'm a huge, huge fan of journal writing. Anyone knows when they come to talk to me, they're like, bring a journal
bring
and some
a journal.
Kleenex.
Don't forget your journal and some Kleenex.
Kleenex.
Just like Kleenex. So have
bring
it with
a journal
me.
And some Kleenex. Because sometimes I say you're releasing the pain through your pen. And because we are so filled up with everything that has happened in our past, we're not able to let it go. And we're seeking for answers to questions that we will never receive because there's so much bottled up inside of us. So as you're writing in your journal to release that pain, and I say if you're angry with someone that they did something to you, feel comfortable enough to write that anger. Because once you release it, you're creating space for new information. It's always that math question that we can't get the answer to, but once you step away from it and come back, all of a sudden you get the answer immediately. It's the same thing with going through that healing process, starting with the journal writing and giving yourself the permission.
Yes.
Saying you're giving yourself permission to heal.
Journal writing is very powerful. It's proven to be powerful and therapeutic because you do get some distance and you can see it right there in black and white and you can return to it and it gives you a chance to take the emotion out of it and it's like a dump.
Yes.
It's like downloading onto paper.
Yeah, and you can get clarity out of it because now you're able to gain a better understanding of exactly what you've been going through and saying, okay, this really wasn't me, it was someone else. And often our pain is attached to another person. It's not totally ours.
So if there's a woman sitting at home right now and she's in a little bit of pain, and you want her to reach out to you, we would love, you know, we're going to tell people how to reach you.
Yes.
What would you say to that woman directly right now so that she would know that there's hope for her?
As a woman who has suffered from depression, I know that there is hope. There is help. But you have to feel comfortable enough to speak about it. Often we stay hidden and don't want to share with other people some of the challenges that we are facing because to the outside world, everyone looks perfect and everything is okay. And for you to be able to share your vulnerabilities, it makes you feel uncomfortable. So stepping out of your comfort zone and giving yourself permission to share and also ask for help. We don't always have to walk around with our cape on like we're super women and doing everything because when you take care of yourself, you're able to take care of other people, whether you have children or significant others or our family or parents.
So that's a great tip. Let's repeat that. So just taking that first step, just reaching out.
Reaching out.
Just knowing that you're not alone, reach out to the right people.
The right people is key.
Might not be right immediately around you in your immediate circle. Yes. They might be a little bit beyond that.
Correct.
But you're a really good person, or at least a good resource.
Yes.
At the very least for that. Let's talk a little bit more about your journey. On your journey, you have had some weight loss and some transformation in that area. Interesting that you're a transformation specialist. You've had some transformation, and I'm sure and certain, and I know that this has informed your work and deepened your work with women. Mm-hmm. So where does that all come together?
Where does it all come together? So as I mentioned, I had suffered from depression, and with that came medication, which blew me up to 193 pounds. And I said to myself, you know what? It's time to make a transition in your life, time to make a lifestyle change.
Nice.
And that lifestyle change, including changing my eating habits, I found some wonderful products for total life changes, and I started losing the weight. And the journey since June has been absolutely awesome. I surprised my physician when I went to have a checkup.
That's not easy to
do. And she said to me, she's like, Tina, I'm so proud of the changes that you've made in your life because you chose to make a lifestyle change. And now she gave me the flag of she was weaning me off my medication.
Nice.
So I'm happy because I wanted to share that because I want other women to know that
you can be
do
a model.
Have options.
Yeah, you can inspire others. If,
and so with that and with women seeing my own personal transformation and also me being very transparent with the journey.
Yeah.
That it took for why it started and how I got to this point now, it makes them more comfortable to really open up and speak about it and not feel like they're going to be judged.
Yeah, it gives people permission to just be themselves and feel safe doing that. So I really acknowledge you for what it takes for you to let yourself be vulnerable and the way in which I'm sure that's inspiring many people. So with the work that you do, it's taken many forms, and one of the interesting forms I've seen is that you do these retreats far away, in far away places, wonderful tropical places.
They're not that far.
Some of them are not that far. They're not on totally the other side of the world, but you do them in Anguilla and other places. Mm-hmm. Could you say a little bit about that, and why would a woman, what's the benefits of that? Why would a woman want to join you on one of your retreats? For women only.
For women only. Sorry, fellas, but for women only.
This time.
The Women's Remember Me Retreat focuses on the woman who wears all of these hats and forgets to practice self-care. And the reason why I take them to the Caribbean, because I want them to leave everything and anything at home, all of the cooking, the laundry, and all of the extra stuff, the work. Leave it at home, because once you get onto the island, you're focusing on yourself and you are catered to. Each retreat has been different because I've held it in Jamaica, Turks and Caicos, and finally Anguilla, which is going to be the home base for now. And the ladies come onto the island apprehensive because they're unsure what's going to happen, and they return home with a different outlook on their life. The experience is unique because I create the agenda based on their personal life. For example, the retreat in May, the ladies were on the beach playing, and some of them had crystals, so they were playing with their crystals, and the other ones were frolicking in the water. And I looked at them and they were like little children.
Yeah.
And so the next morning, their meditation focused on their inner child.
Nice.
And when we started the discussion, they said, "Where did you get that topic from?" And I said, "I observed you like children
on the
beach."
You paid attention. Mm-hmm. Yeah. That's beautiful how that shows up and how it evolves.
Yes.
And that's really the way the journey is. Yeah. It sounds beautiful.
It's
I hope people will reach out to you about that. We'll give your information. So tell us what you're up to in the world then, and how people can reach you. Lots of things.
I'm doing lots of things. One of the things that I enjoy doing, I love being face to face with my sisters. Yeah. And because it allows me to really tap into some of their challenges. So I started hosting the Women's Circle at the Center for Healing and Relaxation.
Where's that?
That's in Plainsboro, New Jersey.
Plainsboro, New Jersey. Relaxationandhealing.com.
Remember, relaxationandhealing.com. And I love it because it gives them an opportunity to see me face to face and receive the help that they need. We create topics, but often we go off topic because I'm pulling from the energy that the ladies are discussing. So that's one of the things that I'm doing face to face. I also have a monthly women's circle. I invite people into my virtual living room. So we
have a
monthly phone call.
Presence.
I have a strong virtual presence. So
yes.
They come into my virtual living room and we have discussed different topics of discussion. And it's an awesome experience. And of course, my retreats. And one thing that I've added for 2016, since my Women's Remember Me retreat is sold out, I just added a Girlfriend's Self-Love Weekend at the Mansion in Noble Lane in Bethany, Pennsylvania. So this will be my first U.S. gathering for over 14 women.
Wow, that sounds really nice. So if people want to check that out, what's your website?
My website is tinachines.com. That's TinaChines.com. And I'm also on social media as well.
People can follow you. They can find out all the mischief that you're up to in the world. And I really hope that people will do it. They will follow you. They won't regret that. So any last inspirational couple of words that you have for the women and men?
You know, I have this favorite quote that I often share with my ladies, and it is very simple. When you feel good internally and externally, there is no makeup required.
Oh, that's beautiful. Thank you for that beautiful message. Yes. Thank you, Tina, for being here.
I am
pleasure
glad to
having
be here.
You.
Thank you.
I hope you enjoyed the show as much as I did and that you got something really big out of it. I would love to hear from you, so let me know what you thought about today's show. Reach out to me at my contact information or on social media. So in this world, remember, there's something that you can do every day. It's just be kind to yourself and others. And join me next time on Positive Energy.